Before we get started with this episode, I just want to take a moment to let you know how it happened. The designer of this game reached out to me and expressed a desire to help those in this crisis. Not only the players with the free print and play game, but also the friendly local gaming stores. So if you email Board Game Raccoon proof of a purchase from a local gaming store, they are going to send you previously unreleased content for this game we're going to do in the video, Der Klau Roland Heist. You're going to get the Great Train Robbery Campaign just for buying another board game. I mean, don't get no better than that. So again, email Board Game Raccoon. I'm going to include a link at the bottom of this, or in the video description, of where to send it to and more information on this. Right now, as of this recording, the only stores listed to be supported in this way are ones in Germany and Austria. But you know what? I'd say take a shot at it. What's the worst that could happen? Now, on to the game. Released in 2020, designed and illustrated by Benjamin Schultz and published by Board Game Raccoon, Der Klau Roland Heist is a roll and write game where you have to use the tools and abilities of your character to get the most out of your heist. From the kiosk to the Tower of London, from the cash box to the crown jewels, see if you can pull off the perfect heist. This game is solo from the start, and once you know all the icons and rules, you should be able to get through a play of it in about 30 minutes. In this video, I'm going to go over a quick tutorial of how to play the game and all its rules, and then I'm going to play through the kiosk scenario with our crook, Matt. So won't you join me now as I solo play Der Klau Roland Heist. Hey everyone, here we have Der Klau Roland Heist set up for our solo play. We've chosen Matt as our avatar. Raised as an orphan, he has become a skillful crook who already acquired a certain reputation. Matt is going to try to go ahead and thievery, to knock over, to steal from the kiosk. Life in a big city is expensive. Too expensive, you think. And so you desperately need money. The kiosk around the corner has a full safe, a fully stocked cash register, and a lot of other things that can be made into cash. So, what could possibly go wrong? So let's look at our special rules for the kiosk. Once the back door has been opened, you have 3 rounds to overcome the watchdog, meaning strike off every symbol every round to count the rounds. So once I break into here, at the end of each round, I'm going to cross off one of these time markers. Otherwise, the dog's going to trigger the alarm. The alarm's going to trigger a race away, and we're going to talk about that in a little bit. So what is Der Klau Roland Heist? Well, it is a roll and write game of thievery. We got taking our man Matt. He's going to use his natural given abilities and his tools, the lockpicks, wire cutters, and stethoscope to break into the kiosk. So we've got 2 boards here. We've got the player board and we've got the location board. Let's take a closer look at our player board. So the first thing on this player board we're going to see is our avatar with a description, kind of a background story, which I read in the beginning. And then we have this. This is our turn order. First, we're going to roll our 3 dice. Then we're going to use our dice to write in here, either to fill in or cross out numbers. any unused dice are going to be called traces. We're going to be leaving traces at the scene. Too many traces and we get caught. And traces are also going to take points away from us at the end because it was sloppy work. So we're going to roll our dice, use the dice. Any unused are going to be left over as traces. And then you're going to score out the time, meaning you're going to cross off one of these. And when we get, you only have so many, so much time before the alarm triggers. Once the alarm triggers, there's a really fun getaway escaping mechanic that we'll get to later. And then if you haven't run out of time and have to do the escape, you have the choice to run away. If you run away, you get scot-free. Anything that you've collected in that game is your score. You score up. So that's going to be a general run through of the turns. Let's take a little bit look at what we're going to be doing, the meat of our turns. So there's going to be a whole lot of icons, and right here on the side here they have a nice iconography map here: strength, dexterity, cunning, lockpicking, electronics, sneaky, safecracking. This means I can increase a number or decrease a number by that number. You get an extra dice. Write any number or cross off any circle. So those are that's the iconography here. So he's got natural abilities of strength, dexterity, and cunning. These are kind of like number lines. As I fill in, I just have to follow the requirements that are set in either in the box or between the boxes. So here, this first one has to be greater than one. And then this next one, it has to be less than this number. Here, you have to have greater than four. And then this number actually has to be equal to the one you placed before. So there's a really fun sequencing here of playing with the numbers. The symbols underneath the boxes are your benefits, which you're going to get after putting a number in that box. And it's really important to note that once you put a number in that box, you get that good. It's not like I can unlock it and then use it later on. I have to use it when I unlock it. So that's going to be a huge timing thing here in this game. So it's really fun. If it was just I can go through here and unlock them and then use them as I need them, a lot of tension is removed from the game. So really clever there. So you've got your natural abilities here, and then you've got your tools down here. And this are three different kind of like mini games. I really like that each one's a little bit different, and each player has a different tools that they use. And although they're somewhat similar, they're going to be different in some ways. So here, if we look at the lockpicks here, when I get a number or value, I'm just going to cross out a circle that I want to cross out. And once I get connected all in a row, I'm going to get the benefit at the end of that line. So if I cover 6, 5, and 8, I would then get a dexterity to use. Here are the wire cutters. This is kind of like a tree. I start here with a 1, and I get a dexterity. And then I have the choice to go to 4 or 7. The important thing is here, once I choose a path, I have to continue for that path. I can't go 1, 4, 7. Or I'm sorry, I can't go 1, 4, 9, and then come down here to 7. I have to finish this row out. So I've got some choices there. It's kind of like fork in the road tree map. Then your stethoscope here, this is going to be a long-term commitment here to get these. You're going to put a number on it. Here it has to be greater than 3, so say I put a 4. I write that in the box. After that, the next 4 I get, I can cross out the box, and then I get the benefit. So really, I have to put 2 of the same number on a spot in order to get it. You can do it in the same turn. Say I get 2 5s, and I want to do this is greater than 3, or and I can do 5 and cross it out if I wanted to. On the bottom, these are specials here. His specials of nimble fingers. So I can trade any dexterity for one of these other symbols. So when I unlock one of these dexterity, these handprints, I'm going to be able, I could, instead of using it at the kiosk, I could enact one of my special abilities from my nimble fingers, and meaning I would cross out one of these and then get that benefit. Here, obviously, I'd have to cross off one and then cross off another one and then finally get it. But super, super clever that each character is a little bit different in their special ability. And then I've got these ongoing. This is a one-time. Once I cross it out, just like these ones up here, it's gone. I can't use it anymore. But these are ongoing. His ongoing special is he's a crook. Any two of a kind, I can increase or decrease the value by 2. Any three of a kind, and I get to just have a free lock-picking ability. So that is the player mat. Let's take a look at the our job, the kiosk. We're going to try to take on the kiosk here. You always start with the location with the diamond that's crossed out. So we're going to be working at the front door first. Anything that's doubled is a room, is an activity, is one thing. Double box here. You can see a double box, double box, double box, double box. And then there's a single box on the outline here. That's like a whole area. Once I get into this area, gain access through this one, I'm going to be able to do anything in these, in this section. But each one is separate, skill, tests, whatever. So in order to get into this room, I have to first take out the front door. And this game is real nice because it gives you options in order to achieve it. So I can either break out the front door by lockpicking it for one lock, or I could do two fists, two strength, what is it called? Yeah, two strength to knock the door down. All right, very thematic, I like that. Once I've completed either the top or bottom portion of this, I'm gonna cross out this diamond, and now I've gained access to this room. Now, I could hang out in the sales room for a while and pick off the shelves and the cash register. And these ones, again, the cash register is very similar. Anything in the arrow, though, I want to indicate here, indicates that you need to do it first in this order. So I have to cross out this one and get this one first, then this one, then this one, and so forth and so on. So anything with an arrow says I have to do it in that order. So I can sit here and work on the shelves, the cash register, and working on the back door, however I want moving forward. Anything that I unlock from my player board, I can now cross off here. I can't cross off anything in this yet because I haven't knocked the back door down. Once I knock down the back door, I could essentially put cross out anything from any of these areas. Remembering that I now did trigger, remember, our special rule here for the kiosk is once I knock this back door down, the watchdog is going to bark and bark and bark and bark for, and if he barks for three times, the alarm is going to be triggered. Oh, so woke somebody up, or the neighbors are calling. Oh, your dog is barking, whatever, from the kiosk. But again, choice of top or bottom. And then I get here. The interesting thing is anything here with this on the bottom is loot. Okay, so say here I use a cunning and I cross this out. I then cross out this one here, and at the bottom, at the end of the game, I'll add this one to my loot score. Okay. Other area on this is the timer. Playing with one player, one investigator, or not one investigator, one crook. You're going to start here. Playing with two crooks, you'll start. You'll cross these out here and start your time there. Three crooks, you'll start there. Very, very interesting. This is the trace tracker. If I only have one crook, I'm going to cross out starting here. Two crooks there, three crooks there. And then this is once we trigger this one, we cross this out. Which happens at the end of a round, I then immediately, if it crosses the alarm, I immediately go to the escape, which is very, very, very clever. So the escape is, I look at my crook's escape ability, and if it is less than 5, I'm going to cross out one of these escapes. If it is greater than 2, I'm going to cross out one of these police chases. And as I do this, I'm going to just cross out either or both, depending on if they can both fall into that category of greater than or less than 5, greater than 2. So yes, it can. I could technically cross out both. And whichever one I cross out, the last one in first happens. I either escape or I get caught and sent to prison. Cool. Like I said, these boards are a huge part of what make this game so fantastic. You see Bruce has a crowbar, a drilling machine, and dynamite. And Janet, she's got the glass clutter and the gloves, and she's got the power and girl's best friend, like all these different, really. So each character is definitely going to play differently. And then here, we're using the kiosk, which is the lowest in difficulty level. There are other ones that are much more difficult here. This tax return, the security team actually stops you from being able to work in offices, different rooms, even though you might have gotten into them, depending on where that. Or you can take them on and beat them up or sleuth by them, but you're going to leave those traces, and oh, only 4 traces here. So lots of different options here in terms of how you're going to play it. Let's get into the kiosk just so you can see some gameplay here. All right, here we go. So we're going to start with Matt trying to steal from the kiosk. We begin with rolling our 3 dice. Okay, so we got 4, 4, and 5, which automatically triggers our crook ability. Any 2 of a kind get to add or subtract 2 to a value. So let's take a look. We're coming in here at the front door. We want to lockpick or we want to bust it down. So one really fun thing about this game is a strategy of resource management. Let's count it up. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. There's a total of 6 strength that I would possibly have to use in order to achieve something. If I look at Matt, he's got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 strength. So he's not going to be able to get through this with just his strength. So I have to be really smart about, okay, here I'm going to lockpick, but he, or maybe here I'm going to use my strength and here I'm going to lockpick. He's got a lot more lockpicking options. So maybe that's something I just say, you know what? I'm going to forego strength everywhere and I'm going to lockpick. It's just really fun to manage, you know, how much dexterity he has. Can he, if I do it here, will I have enough to, and realistically be able to get up to that number before time runs out. So clever. So I've got 2 4s and a 5. Two of a kind, I can add or subtract 2 to anything. So this could really be a 2, it could be a 6, this could be a 3, this could be a 7. I know you're impressed with my math skills already. So we're trying to bust in the front door. 7. This is greater than 1. This first number has to be greater than 1. So I could go down this route. But if I go down here, I am not going to I'm going to forego my electronics. So let's see if there's any electronics that I need. I'm not seeing the display case. I won't be able to do the display case, which would be 3 cash. I'd have to make sure I get all these other ones. A score of 14 is considered a great clow. So 4, 5, 6, 7, that would put me at 14. I'd have to get everything else. It wouldn't be a perfect heist. So coming down here is a little risky. I've got 2 4s. I could put this 4 here. It's greater than 3, and I could get close to unlocking, but that's going to waste a safe action, and I don't really want to do that because I've only got one other one. Maybe these are the 2, but I'd have to get 6, 11, and 14. Not an easy thing here. We could get 5 and 8 in this row and get that dexterity going. But for some reason, early game, I'm always drawn to getting these abilities going just so I can have an idea of what I need. Both of these are blank. Well, this isn't the greater than symbol, so it's just 1 saying I have to start there. So greater than 1. Blank, blank. But the thing is, I can't just get started willy-nilly here. I've got to unlock something here. So maybe I can do my 5. 4, 5, 6. I could get a 10. I could make it a 10. I forgot to mention, like, you can combine dice. So this could be a 9. Obviously, like, with numbers like 14 and 15, I'd have to start combining these 3 dice. But if I combine them all, what's that? 8 and 5 is 13. 13 minus 2, I could get that 11 right away and just say, you know what, I'm going to start working towards this, because if I put work in here, I'm going to be able to get my doors picked pretty quickly. And then it looks like it's a lot of cunning, maybe safe, so I can maybe also work towards that safe. So yeah, let's maybe start filling out our users, start using our lock picks to get through this front door. This adding or subtracting 2 is very intriguing. If I go down 2, I could do 6 here. That gets me in line for some dexterity, not the lockpicking. I need the lockpicking first. So I've got a 9. That could help here. Oh, yeah, let's do that. Let's do this 9. And then I'm going to use my subtract 2, because I had 2 of a kind, and make this a 2 and cross this one out as well. So now we're looking for, we've really pigeonholed ourselves here to need a 14 to get this next one. I also get that 1 and 7, which could be pretty interesting. But we've used all our dice, we've left no traces. So we score our time, we're going to cross out our first one here. And then, are we going to run away? No, we're not going to run away. So we're going to roll again. Oh, and look at that. 1 and 7. It's super, I'm not happy about wasting this one, but I don't think there's another way. I got the 3 and a 6. Ooh, that was close. If that was a 3, I could have done this row and done that, but that wouldn't have got me in. I've got to get in. So let's use this one. We're going to cross out the, you're going to use our wire cutters. Don't know how, just to get it going. And then I'm going to, I forgot. I wasn't going to go down that way because I won't have the electronics. That's why, because I want to get into the display case. Ooh, but am I thinking too far ahead? Is that going to ruin me here? Let's see what options we got. 5, 6, 7, 8. I could go here with an 8. I really just need to get that door in. Matt, you're not good with doors at this point. I got so much building up here to do. All right, 5, 6. I could go the 6 here. That doesn't really help with the door. 4. Nope. I could do the 8.
That gets us one closer here. Let's do that. Let's do the 8. Really, really taking our time with this door. All right, 5, 5, 5. Ooh, 3 of a kind. Oh, and look at that. I get that automatically with the 3 fives. Wow. Yep, I'm going to take that right now. And I'm going to cross that out. So now I can start working here, which is nice because I've put the groundwork to get some so I can kind of work on the back door while I start stealing some stuff. So let's, look at here. We can do a 5 and a 5 right here. 5 and 5, and I get a cunning, which I'm going to use at the cash register, because I think 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Maybe I just punched the dog. And then I use 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's still tough. Oh, man, maybe I should have done dexterity on that. It just looks so pretty with the 5 and the 5. It all had set itself up so well. I'm not sure. Oh, but 2 of any kind, I can still use this one as well. I trigger both, so I could still add 2. So let's see. Let's take that back. Just because I am going to want to break into that safe. That's 7 points. I'll use my dexterity here. So what if I use this one to go down to 3, and then we do a 5 here. So this became a 3. This became a 5. I get my dexterity. And then I have a 5 left. I could cross off this 5. Yes. And that was working on both dexterity and a lock. Very good. That was a good round. What a lucky roll. All right, 3 turns in. We are in the sales room, and we are moving our way along. Oh, we got another 2 of a kind, so we get to add. I think I'm going to do add 2 to this, 5, 6, 7. I'm just going to put it aside as a 7. Write that 7. Get my, I left a clue, a trace, excuse me. But I do get the cash, which means I scored 4 points so far. If I decide to run away now, I would get 4 points. I've got these 2 threes. I'm trying to figure out, maybe I go with this 6. Yeah, I could go this 6 here. And that's going to give me another dexterity, which I'm swiping stuff off the shelf now. And that's another point. That's all she wrote for that round. So cross it off. We're moving along here now. We got a 3, 4, and 5. No extra abilities here. We need to get 11. Oh, 9, 10, 11, 12. Ah, just missed it. See, I could do this 3 and swipe another thing. Because I'm going to need 1 dexterity, and I should be able to reach it there. So if I put that 3 there, I could swipe another thing off the shelf while I wait. And I get closer to another possible one. That gives us 9. We've got the 4. I could put the 4 there. That's another one super close. I'm not going to need any more locks after this, so I might as well do that. So let's do this 3, and we're going to swipe another item. And we're going to do this 4, which gets us closer to unlocking. We need an 11 and a 14. That seems interesting. Then I've got a 5 here. Maybe I start putting some work here. I've got to prepare for that dog, because once I knock it down, I'm going to have to get it. So I don't want to start with a 5, because then I'd only be able to do a 6 there. And that might not come up. So I think the safest bet with this 5 is going here. I'm going to need 2 saves. So greater than 6, greater than 6. Oh, his stethoscope sucks. Going here is not going to be doing much good for me. Although I get that other one here if I get that 11, 14, which I'm trying. So let's do it. Oh, man, I don't know. Let's do this one, 5. No, that's less than 3. Shoot. I could put this 5 here and hope for that cunning. Because cunning let me cross out anything, and I can do that 11 or 14. So let's put that 5 there. If we run into another 5, I know I'm going to be able to cross off something, which is nice. But again, I don't know if I want to cross out just yet, because I don't have a way to deal with that dog. And I'd only have 3 rounds, unless I think I can get in that safe and get out in 3 rounds, which I don't know. All right, we finished that round. Let's see what we got. 2 threes, 2 of a kind I can increase. Although I don't know if I want to. I can do 1 and a 4. No, I can't do that. Is it 1 there? Do I have the dexterity? No, the last is a strength there. I don't know if I'm going to get that one. I want to be able to kind. I wonder if I do 11. No, that'd be 9. A lot of low numbers here. I could do this. I don't need it yet. I don't need that. Although it's going to let me cross off something, which would let me unlock a door. That would, if I put it 11, I'm going to unlock it and go right to that dog and have 3 turns. Maybe we do this. We get going with those fists. Maybe I'll just punch that dog once and be done with it and leave that for the safe. So greater than 1, let's put a 3. And then we'll use our pluses to go 3. It's got to be greater than 3. If I do this one to add 2 more to make it, that's the 3, and I make it 2 more, that makes this one 5. And I get a 2 value. So I have a 1 and a 2, which could, I've got a 1 and a 2. What was it? It wasn't a 2, was it? Yeah, it was a 2. I've got a 1 and a 2. Which is 3. So maybe I go 4. And I can't get there. And I can't get that 5. The 1 and the 2 is only 3. Less than 3. Maybe I go here with the 2. And I go here with the 1. Oh, yeah. So I can use the, maybe I cross out 4. What do I need? I don't think I need another lock. Maybe. Maybe I can't get that 11. Let's do that. We'll cross that one out there. I get another 2. I can eventually cross out one of those, and then I just need this one. That could work out. All right, so that's everything in that round. Let's go ahead and cross out that time. We're not running away yet. We have a total of 4, 5, 6 points right now. Let's see if we can get through that door and knock that dog off. 1, 2, 3. Bunch of lows. I didn't want that either. Still can't break that down. Want to punch that dog. Can't do that yet. Oh, this could have been, this might have been a really bad roll. 3, 4, 5, 6. 6. Can't place it. I could put it here, but it's a waste. I'm using it, saving that one for the dog. Oof. I might be leaving a lot of clues here this turn. 3, 4, 5. Okay, yeah, let's do this. Okay, yeah. Oh, that's kind of sucks. Because all right, let's trigger it. We're going to get that 5 here, which gives us the dexterity. Oh, I don't need it here. I'm going to use it here, and it's going to let me cross out a number. I'm going to cross out this 11. I'm going to cross out then these 2 locks, which then triggers that dog, which I am left with a 1 here. Chihuahua, and I think that 1's going to be a clue, because it's got to be greater than 5, greater than 7, greater than 4. These all have to be greater than. I don't have my 1 anymore, so I am going to leave another clue behind on that one. But I'm through the door, and now I can take on this dog, hopefully. So we're going to cross off here. 1 here and 1 there. And let's see. We need something. Greater than 4. Okay, we did it. We got 2 of a kind, which lets me add 2. Oh, let's do this. Yeah, we got to take out that dog because we're going to lose a time with it. 1, 2, 3. Am I ready? No. I could add 2 here, go to 4. And then I'm closer to being able to get that display case. Although here I want to be greater than 5. Huh. Oh no, I'm going to use this one here. So I need a 14. So getting here greater than 5 would be very important. So let's do this. Let's do... Oh, I think I'm just off to be able to do both of those. But I'm going to, because I know I'm going to take that dog out. Let's take that dog out. So I'm going to do 5. I added this one to be 5. Greater than 4 is 5. That's a fist and a time. Takes care of the watchdog. Now I've got this 5, and I wanted to go, I wish I had enough to go there, because then I could cross out that one and be closer to that safe. I've got this 2, though, so I could do the 2, but what would that leave me with a 3? I don't really have an option for that. I'm leaving a lot of clues, man. This is not good. So I think we're going to cross out that 2. We're going to use our stethoscope again. Cross out that one, which means we need that 14. And this is that we need to get there. This 3, I don't think I can put anywhere, so I am going to have to take that as another clue. Another trace. I guess this clue for detectives traces. Let's cross out some time. We knocked out the watchdog, so we don't have to worry about that anymore. Okay, we got a big number finally. Haven't been getting a lot of bigs. Let's see, 6, 2, and 1, 8, 9. Nope. Oh, yep, we can do that. Cross that out, get through the safe. That would be good. But then we'd have to do this electronics here. Dexterity is pretty easy enough. So let's do that. Let's do greater than 5. I think I'm going to use all of it because I don't think I have anywhere else I can put anything that I'd want to. So let's go 6, 7, 8, 9. We're going to put that 9 right there, which lets us cross out this number, which lets us cross out this safe, which lets us get this cash. Nice, right? Okay, that's the end of that turn. Now, am I going to be greedy and try to get that electronics and then that? I need a 4 and a 9, or do I leave right now? I'm going to get plus 1 per time, so I'm going to run away, actually, right now. And let's call this a quit. I don't think I'm going to be able to get a 4 and a 9. Do I have any more that'll let me just cross out a circle anywhere? No. So I'd have to get straight up a 4 and a 9. And then greater than 5, greater than that. So, or it's actually greater than 7, greater than, I think that's an uphill battle for Matt. So I'm going to stop right there. I'm going to decide to run away. So let's go ahead and total our stuff up. First, I'm going to count up all my loot. I got 7, 8, 9. Oh, wait, hold on a minute. Oh, would I get that fist? A 4 and a 2? No, but we're gonna cut our losses and we're going to go. I don't want Matt to risk. He's going to lose some points here with clues, though. Do I push it and try to at least get one more thing here? A 4 and a 2, that seems possible. All right, we're doing it. We're rolling. Oh, God, nope. I got the 4. Oh, I got the 4. And I get the plus or minus 1, so that's going to be this one. I'm going to make this a 2. Which lets me get this one, which is another point, whatever. And then, oh, but I think I'm going to leave a clue here with this 3. Oh, it's got to be greater than 3? Shoot, yeah. So I'm going to leave another clue, another trace, which is -2. So I actually lost a point on that one. So Matt's going to leave now. It's a bad idea. So we're going to cross out that time, and I'm going to just get one time left. So loot, I've got 7, 8, 9, 10, 14, and there's one time left, so I get 1, and that's a 15 score. Traces minus 2 per 2, 4, 6, 8. Matt was very sloppy, and I didn't hit the alarm. 15 minus 8 is 7. So Matt scored 7 on the kiosk. That's been Der Clou, Der Clou, Rollin' Heist. I want to thank you guys for watching. I hope you enjoyed.
And in rock and roll, an unknown band suddenly found themselves with the number one hit in the country. These New Yorkers first met as rivals in a Battle of the Bands contest on Long Island, New York. They then decided to team up as Brooklyn Bridge. And here they are with their only hit, The Worst That Could Happen.